Good morning and welcome to First Christian Church. We are disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. We are so thankful you have joined us today, both in person here in the sanctuary and also those of you watching through our streaming services. You are welcome here. I'm Beth Ramsey, your serving elder for this morning. I encourage you to please read your biweekly emails from the church office. They're a wonderful trove of information and announcements and activities. I actually looked at the crossword puzzle this week. Just a couple of quick announcements. The outreach team will be over cleaning and weeding in Brown Park on Saturday, weather pending. Please bring your gloves and your weeding tools and maybe a trash bag. Coffee and donuts will be available for volunteers. And if the weather gets silly like it did last month, I will post through the Facebook page about any cancellations. Lots of meetings coming up this week. The elders, stewardship, outreach, fellowship. Again, check your email for times and places. We also have the food donation going for Camp Christian Free Store, and the container is inside the parking lot doors. And again, see the email for items needed, special emphasis placed on protein items for that food drive. So at the risk of telling a story about flooding on a rainy day, there is this story that I know I use it frequently in sessions in my job, and it's a wonderful story, sort of, about a man who lived in a flood area, and the floodwaters are coming, and he's sitting on his front porch watching it rain. And the sheriff pulls up in his truck and says, "Sir, come get in my truck. The floodwaters are coming. Your house is going to be destroyed." And the man says, "No, I'll wait. Thank you. I have full faith in the Lord. The Lord will provide. The Lord will take care of me. I don't need to leave." Sheriff says, "Okay." Next time the sheriff comes by in the boat, the man is sitting on the roof of his porch with the first floor of his house underwater. And the sheriff says, "Man, get in the boat." Man says, "No, I have full faith in the Lord. God will take care of me. I know that God will provide. I will be safe." Sheriff shrugs his shoulders and off he goes. Third time sheriff shows up in the helicopter, the man is sitting on the roof of his two-story home with the water lapping up to the gutters. And through the bullhorn, the sheriff says, "Grab the rope, we will lift you to safety." And the man again, "No, I have faith in the Lord. God will provide, God will take care of me." And the helicopter takes off and the man drowns. And he gets to heaven and he meets God. And he says, "I had faith in you. I had full faith that you would provide and you would take care of me." And God just shook his head. "I sent the sheriff three times." When we call out, do we keep our eyes fully open? Or are we squinting only to see what we want God to send? I invite you, if you would like, to please stand and join me in our responsive reading of Psalm 13 as our morning call to worship. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I bear pain in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day long? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep the sleep of death. And my enemy will say, "I have prevailed." My foes will rejoice because I am shaken. But I trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask that you are present and bless our worship. We do trust in your steadfast love and presence in our lives. May we continue to stand firm on the foundation you provide. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to remain standing as we sing together our opening hymn of praise, How Firm a Foundation, verses 1, 3, and 5.
To the children at home and to the grown-up children in the sanctuary, we have four grandchildren ranging in age from 5 to 13. And those of you who know me probably won't be surprised to know that all four of them are very determined and very emotional children. And they have each gone through their phases of having a hard time accepting the answer no. But our grandson right now is particularly having trouble with that. He will soon be 10 at the end of this month. And one of the things that he tells his mom, Kristen was sharing with me this week, is whenever he is beseeching her about something and the answer is not suitable to his liking, he will say, "You just don't understand." And she says, "I do understand, yet the answer is still no." It's either something that she doesn't have power over to change, or it's something that she's choosing not to change because it's not in his best interest. But how often are we that way? When we're not getting the answer we want from God, and it seems like he's saying no, or maybe he's saying not yet, we just say, "But you don't understand." Well, there was a time when in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was struggling with the idea of going to the cross, whether he was deeply mourning, leaving his disciples who still didn't seem to get it, whether he was excruciatingly remorseful about having to go through that pain, or both, we don't know, but he beseeched God to take the cross from him, and God said no, and Jesus said, "Okay." He never said, "But you don't understand." So I think it's a lesson for us to take the no's or the not yet's in our life and to have the faith that God is still in our corner. He still is loving. He is all-powerful. He can change anything that he knows is best to change, and he will change anything he knows is best to change, in his way and in his time. Will you pray with me? Lord God, help us to trust you more. Help us to take your no or your not yet and have faith that you still do have our best interests at heart. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm watching our technical crew, and things look pretty good back there. They're pretty busy, so I'm encouraged that I don't have to kill time.
Well, I thought we had a stewardship video, but it's not playing.
Oh, the video's not playing for stewardship. That's okay. We don't need a stewardship every single Sunday. We know why we come here. We know that God asks of us something. Everything that we do have does belong to God, and there's a time and place for us to give things back. And we do have a moment in our worship service. We'll come forward today to pick up our communion elements. And as we do so, Sierra is standing by one of the gold platters that you can set your tithe or offering in if you so desire. But of course, there's also other ways of contributing through the Tithely app. So again, we just ask that we pray over all the gifts that we receive, and then also over all of the givers, for the ministry be done here on earth, that we can make a meaningful and a relative statement about our faith within our community through the gifts we have to offer. The scripture today comes from the prophet of Habakkuk. Selected verses from chapter 1 and 2. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you not listen? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write a vision, make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end, and it does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. Word of God for the people of God. Join me in a quick prayer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The closing words from the scripture I had read. The righteous live by their faith. The righteous live by their faith. Praise God. We are invited to live by our faith every moment of every day. So what does live by your faith mean to you? Maybe that's a hard question first thing on a Sunday morning, or maybe you all have been out and about doing projects and you had to cut them short to worship with us today. But what does it mean for us to live by our faith? When one lives by their faith, We recognize there are moments that bring joys into one's heart, like toddlers that climb stairs. We revere or we lift up being able to serve as a mentor, visiting with someone who is struggling, making charitable contributions, simply just smiling at strangers, or living an honest and respected life. There are many other daily observances that one can enact to feel good about themselves and God's activity in this world. So celebrate. Maybe celebrate is a bit too strong of a word here, but I do think it's okay for us to celebrate the good things that are being done, even if they are seemingly insignificant. We need to remember to pause, to stop, and thank God for our blessings. Today, in this worship service, we celebrate coming together, whether virtually or in person. Those of us that have gathered today, we celebrate being able to come forward as one body to pick up our communion elements, so that we can go back to our seats and partake together. We are grateful that we are free to worship, to live by our faith, and as Christians, to proclaim Jesus as our Savior. It goes without saying that we live in a world where we need a Savior. The world, I think we all will acknowledge, it's not perfect. We see things that cause suffering. We see brokenness. The world would be better off if there were more agents of unity, people that work actively to break down the barriers between people. We know there's corruption, violence, and reasons for having a bleak outlook on life in cities and also in countrysides. We know that there are individuals that look more towards their own self well-being, people that intentionally cause violence. There are abuses of power, consumerism, and there are some marketplace ethics that make devastating impacts on the earth and to individuals. The poor, the widows, children, those with illnesses and no health insurance to pay for treatments, they suffer without relief in sight. We also acknowledge that we are not currently living in an exclusive period of history where today is the only time people have experienced brokenness in the world. Throughout recorded history, someone or something in the world has been in need of saving. Those that suffer from violence and injustice, they add their voices of desperation and mourning to the cries of Habakkuk. Their pains grow out of needs and become so overwhelming that the anguish and frustration spill into questions of judgment and accusation toward God. How long shall I cry for help and you not listen? Has anyone here ever prayed for God to respond in a certain way and then not gotten that response from God? Heads are nodding. Some of us are ashamed or afraid to raise our hands, but the reality is that, yeah, a lot of us can raise our hands and shake our heads. Yes, we are not alone in our prayers that seemingly go unanswered. The prophet Habakkuk recorded his testimony in response to the things that he saw in his time. Habakkuk saw the world as a place where justice never goes forth. when justice does go forth, it's perverted. Violence prevails on earth, and God is tolerating the evil to persist. To Habakkuk, if God's punishment is for more violence, then that makes absolutely no sense. If there are people that are committing violence and people that are intentionally being unjust to others, God's response is not more violence on those people to punish them. The scriptures tell us, Torah, the law, told Habakkuk that God's commanded order for justice. It's kind-hearted activity directed to the well-being of others. Specifically, the Bible lists widows, orphans, and the destitute. Habakkuk's complaint is against God for trouble and violence that was so prevalent in society. And we today, we share in that same complaint against God. Abraham Heschel writes that Habakkuk wants to know two things in his complaint, in his conversation with God. The first is Habakkuk is asking to receive God's word. He wants an answer for his complaints. Why and for how long? That's the first thing our prophet wanted. The second thing Habakkuk wanted to know was, what was his own response to the word of God going to be? First, he wants to know God's word, and then he wants to know his own response. How will I respond once God does speak to me? There's putting yourself out for some vulnerability, fully acknowledging you might not like what God has to say. The vision that Habakkuk receives is a mystery to us because it's not recorded in Scripture. We can gather, however, that the vision that is received, it's a vision of redemption at the end of days. We can be assured that God's word will happen, but it cannot necessarily be spelled out in words. If it seems slow, God says, wait for it. God reassures the prophet to trust in God. Habakkuk's response to hearing this word of God is that the prophet knows that he has the power to wait on God. For Habakkuk, he's not confronting his own faith. He's not in a quandary. Do I understand? Do I know the right things? Am I following scriptures accordingly? He's not having that kind of internal self-doubt about his faith. Now, the prophet, he's confronting God with his complaint. He is going straight to the face of God to say why and how long. Heschel continues, to sense the living God is to sense infinite goodness, infinite wisdom, infinite beauty. That is the God that we wait on. That is the God that gives us hope. Hope in infinite beauty and wisdom. And that, knowing that, there's a sensation of joy that should be filling us all up. The world, it's not dismal. We know that the wrath, God's wrath, may turn gardens into a desert, yet the prophet will rejoice in the Lord. Because Habakkuk knows, as all of us should know too as well, that there is more God in this world than evil. Habakkuk, he stood at his watchpost and he cast a vision. Where do we stand as a church And what do we see? We are at a crossroads here within First Christian Church, and we have an option. We have an option about where we stand and what vision we are to cast. What will we do as a church in this broken world that is seeking wholeness? Disciples theologians Allen and Williamson had written that we have a responsibility to walk in the way of life and blessing, trusting in God in the midst of the madness of the world. That doesn't mean that we are expected to have a solution for world peace before we all break from here for lunch. Those two individuals, they called it dynamic waiting. Dynamic waiting, defined as persistence and patience. The waiting for the vision takes a lifetime of deeds committed to loving kindness amid an otherwise chaotic world. We need to own up and take some responsibility and be held accountable for the situation we find ourselves in. Dan Dick poses the question, do we accept responsibility for the ways we have created our own reality? Rarely are we without responsibility for what we feel and experience. We all play a part in what we perceive in this world. We know that Protestant Christianity, of which Disciples is a part of, Protestant Christianity is suffering. There are less people in our buildings, less people following us streaming web on our service platforms. We know that as churches, we are not the societal force we once were. So, reflecting back on what Dan Dick had to say, do we seek causes for blame? Do we seek causes for blame? Or do we acknowledge a role for the situation we find ourselves in? As the disciples' scholars point out, our God is a covenantal God who does not do everything himself, but he relies on God's covenantal partners, us, confessing Christians, to carry out their responsibilities. Habakkuk finds himself holding up a mirror that reveals painful and powerful truth that actions have consequences. In the case of the Judeans, back in the time of Habakkuk, the Judeans, with some exception, Habakkuk being one of those, there were some that wanted violence. And so God let them have their violence. Because God lets us deal with the consequences of our own sin. The words of the prophet guide us to a natural conclusion. Where we find ourselves today is in a destination of our own making and design. If we are not as active in the world as we want to be, it is because we have not done enough. Question we have been pondering as a church for quite some time is, are we where we want to be? The church leadership here has answered that question, and they all said no. So now, because we know we're not where we want to be, we have a wide and varied range of questions. Where do we want to be, if not here? And how do we get to this unknown destination? There are echoes of Habakkuk. Why? And for how long? In some preaching traditions, the verses that I shared with you from Habakkuk, they are paired with verses from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. The verses in Luke are the parable of the mustard seed and a saying about discipleship. The pairing is probably because of the point about faith the size of a mustard seed. Such a faith can accomplish great things. The righteous live by their faith. We need to cast a vision that is simple enough for us to share and spread amongst others, simple enough for a runner to read it. This congregation will be challenged to cast such a vision. I am excited to share with you that the leadership of this church, that is the executive board, the elders, and the ministry team leaders, they have all, every one of them, have made a commitment to invest in the people of this congregation. There is a movement that is growing for us to imagine and to be creative as a church. We are going to create a vision for this church that we can all live into together. Leadership is praying and hoping. And we're asking the congregation to join us in our prayers and our hopes that this new vision will guide our next mission steps into our community, whatever that may be. Join us on that journey. Dan Dick points out to us who our God is. Our God is a unifying force of reconciliation and peace. Beyond our understanding of justice, our understanding of justice is you get what is deserved. However, the justice of God is one of wholeness, harmony, and grace. So let's learn from the prophets. Let's learn from the teachings of Christ. Let's read our scriptures and understand what it means to be righteous. What it means to be righteous. Let us stand with our foundation that is built on the Word. Let us live by our faith, and let us cast a vision.
Thank you.
worship today. Let's do something. It's been a while since we've done it. Let's take requests for prayers and concerns from those of us that have joined. Is that all right? If we're comfortable sharing these over our live streaming services, please do so. What are our prayer concerns and joys? Rosanna.
I have two. Hans Nussbaum.
Hans Nussbaum.
Nussbaum and Gressa B.
Nussbaum.
And our daughter Heather. Hans is my nephew.
Any others? Right, right. Going to continue to pray for Bob and Dorothy Notestein as they are. Bob's doing pretty good, but Dorothy is struggling as she's adjusting to their new lifestyle up at Logan Acres Homestead. Yeah. I'm sure fun is the word he is using. Praying for Ron Goff. Had blood clots removed, but he is home yesterday. Yeah, Kathy. Yeah. Definitely going to start praying more for Fred and Meredith. Fred and Ruth Meredith. Joyce's coworker. Okay, yeah. Joyce's coworker is having some health issues, unsure about what they are at this time. And we're also going to be praying for, she's been one of our friends at Logan Acres for quite some time, praying for Aretha Lowe. Keep her in your prayers too as well. I hear the King family has a joy.
Dale and Larry's sister Phyllis turns 90.
Oh. And whose birthday?
Phyllis Moore.
Phyllis Moore.
Turning 90.
Phyllis Moore is the sister of Larry and Dale. And again, she's turning 90 years old. Yeah, Brenda.
CYFPF starts this week.
Yes. That's right. I'm sure they are. I have been reluctant to reach out to them. Praying for Camp Christian, all their camps throughout the summer. This week is CYF camp, but of course we have members from our congregation who are working there. I don't know, remember being a camper myself. You get mail, right? And if you get so many pieces of mail, you're supposed to sing and do different things. I don't know if that works for staff, right? But I don't know if we all wanted to send a card to... Adam and Pamela and Bruce. You know, those are the three that I know. Oh, and Tom is, of course, Tom. Yeah, Tom, the maintenance guy there. So he spends probably more time there than anybody. So, yeah, send those individuals some mail. Tell them we want them to sing for the CYFers. Pamela would probably be all for it. Anyway, anything else? It's a wonderful joy to be able to talk to all of you and engage with our lives. Anything else? Anything from you? Oh, she's getting sleepy. All right, well, shut up, Dad. Let's get going. All right, let's pray to God, all right? Want me to make it a quick one? It's going to be long. I'm sorry. All right, here we go. Let us pray. We pray for Heavenly Lord. We come to you now in a time of so much uncertainty. We are praying for all of God's people. We have listed up so many different names, Lord. I wrote them all down, but we know that there are all these and there are so much more. We pray for the individuals that need mercies, Lord, that you comfort those individuals. We also have so many individuals that we are affiliated through this congregation that are struggling with different health issues. We know there are people that are awaiting heart transplants. We know there are people that are receiving test results they're not too happy with. We know there are people who are home and recovering. We know there are other individuals that have no idea what their problems are, Lord. We ask you to be with each and every one of these individuals. Be merciful with them. Be compassionate with them. And help us, Lord, to remember these individuals as we reach out to them to spend some time and actually caring for these individuals. Lord, we know that there are too many people that are taken from us too soon and too unexpectedly, Lord. We continue to pray for individuals that are victims of gun violence. We continue to pray for the families that lost loved ones through the collapse of the condo in Florida. And we know there are so many other instances like this where people's lives are just cut too short, Lord. We don't understand it. We ask why and how long, but we know, Lord, that we are here to assist with the grieving, and sometimes the best way to do that is to acknowledge and be able to see as you have modeled for us, that sometimes to know how people are grieving is to experience it yourself, as sad and as unfair as that is, Lord. But we are here to care for one another. We lift up so many different joys here in this congregation. We are blessed for birthdays and for age and for anniversaries and for births and for life, Lord, whether short or long. We are blessed by rain, Lord. Blessed by rain, and yet we are aware of the droughts that exist. We celebrate that we have the power to adapt to changes, and that we also have the ability to make needed changes for the healing of our planet. We ask for blessings upon our region, the Disciples of Christ, for Camp Christian, for all our general ministries and offices that provide meaningful assistance to congregations and to people. We ask you also to bless the people within our city of Belle Fountain, within Logan County. And we celebrate the fact that the Logan County Fair is happening this week, Lord. May this be a time of celebration of young people and their passions and everything that goes into us being able to fulfill a role and to learn from one another and to care for, again, your great creation. We pray for this and so much more, Lord, as we recite together the prayer your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now we'll transition to the communion table.
Our world has been filled with challenge since the beginning of time. There is much that has separated humanity from God. Many have prayed for hope and restoration. Many have watched for the sign they thought would come. The world expected a military leader. God sent us his Son to repair what we had broken. Jesus still comes today to help us repair, to help us restore our own brokenness. As we prepare our hearts this morning for communion, I invite you to join me in singing hymn number 387, Bread of the World in Mercy Broken. Today, we get to come forward. And so after the words of institution and our prayer of blessing, I invite you to come down through the center aisles to take your elements and return to your seats by the side aisles as we continue our journey toward restoration and wholeness. So let us recall that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us pray. Merciful and restoring God, as we journey toward the vision we cast, we are grateful for the presence of Christ. We are grateful for his sacrifice of body and blood to restore us in our brokenness to you. We are grateful for the wholeness that you bring. And we continue in our own journey toward bringing your wholeness to this world. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. We invite you to come forward. Thank you.
Join me in prayer. Lord, we have come to this table so that Jesus Christ's name may be glorified according to your grace, O God. Thank you for bidding us to come. May your Spirit guide us on the paths of peace and love as we go from here. Amen. Now join me, stand as you're able to, in singing our closing hymn, Trust and Obey. Of a toddler, she listened to Beth quite well and knew to come forward for the invitation. So let us join me, if you will, in the benediction from Shane Claiborne. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Amen.